Catholic cemeteries provide an environment of comfort and solace for loved ones, a powerful reminder of our eternal life with Jesus Christ. Offer your family this gift by planning for your eternal rest in a Catholic cemetery. To learn more about the work of Catholic funeral and cemetery services, our history, and our Catholic burial traditions, call and visit one of our locations today. We're ready to help ensure that your wishes are met and provide peace of mind for yourself and your loved ones.
I think for me, the call to the priesthood started when I was altar serving back in elementary school, assisting the priest and really wanting to know more about what it was that he did. And going through middle school and high school, I heard a lot of people even invite me, hey, have you ever thought about being a priest? Have you ever thought about this life? And at first, I dismissed it completely. I ignored the call. I had no desire to be a priest. And I said, no, I want to have a wife. I want to have family. I want to have a good paying career in medicine. Graduated from Grand Valley, and I was working in a local hospital as a rapid response transporter. And we were moving a patient from the emergency room to the operating room. And it was 2 o'clock in the morning, and she was dying, and she needed to get into the OR. And she grabs my wrist, and she says, I need to see a priest. And I said, ma'am, there is no priest. It's 2 o'clock in the morning. I'm sorry, you need to get into surgery. But she wouldn't let go of my wrist. I prayed with her, and she was able to get through surgery. Fast forward a couple of years, just a little gnawing feeling in the back of my mind about this call, because I had not really been satisfied with the work I've been doing in life. So I stopped to fill up for gas, and I see a kid across the way filling up, and he's staring at me. It's making me really uncomfortable. And he's like, he asked me this question. He's like, do you work at the hospital? And I said, I did. And he's like, you probably don't remember this, but you helped my grandma get through surgery a couple of years ago. And because of that, I came back to my faith the following year and brought my parents back into the faith the year after that. And then he walked away. And I was left there at a gas station at 7 o'clock in the morning in my car crying, because I knew at that point I had shut the door on the idea of the priesthood so many times that this time God just took the hinges right off the door and said, what do you have to lose?
So I grew up in St. Peter and Mount Clemens, and kind of always involved in the church growing up. My parents were very active in the church. I was an altar server. My mom helped with the altar servers. My dad was in the Knights of Columbus. So really grew up around the church and had a lot of people who always asked me if I'd thought about the priesthood. And I never really considered it. I always wanted to have a family. And it was during that adoration that I heard God ask the question of whether I should be a priest. And I started evasive maneuvers, tried to think of anything else during that period of adoration, and really couldn't get away from that question. And really for the next month, just kind of sat with it on my own and found I couldn't really think of anything else. You know, starting to look at the vocations page website. Once I started letting people in, telling people what I was thinking about, there was not a level of surprise like I thought there might be. In fact, it seemed to be the exact opposite. It was, people were like, oh good, you finally figured it out. You finally see what we've seen all these years and how the Lord uses other people to confirm what he's doing in our lives, that we're not just discerning in a vacuum or even just between me and God, but that it really is a discernment of the whole community.
I was praying pretty intentionally, asking the Lord for about 2 years, the first 2 years of high school. A discernment has to come from a place of peace. It can't come from a place of fear. And so if you're feeling afraid, if you're contemplating the call or that you might be a priest and that's making you feel afraid, then you can pretty much rule out that this is the moment when you're gonna make the decision. But I was at this youth group meeting, and we were doing praise and worship together as a youth group, and I found a great sense of peace came over me. I realized in my mind, I have everything I need right now. if I want to say yes to this. And it was incredible. It was a remarkable thing to just sort of make that realization. This right now is the Lord's invitation. And so I kind of took myself away from everyone, and I paused, and after a few minutes it just came out. The yes came out, and I almost hardly remember the second of saying yes, but I remember the second after saying, I can't believe that just happened. I can't believe I just did that, but I knew it was real. And immediately, even more peace flooded in, even more joy flooded in. I knew that the Lord was pleased with my yes. I knew that He was blessing it. I knew that He was blessing my future. I did have some reservations, you know, especially as I got older and matured more. I did more and more want to be married. I did more and more want to have a family. But I think my whole journey up until this very moment could be described as God making good on the trust that I placed in Him, and changing me more and more so that this is exactly what I want to do with my life. And it's been wonderful for me to behold the Lord's fidelity.
I'd like to be a priest that's both faithful and forgotten. And to be faithful in the daily work of getting up every day and ministering to the people of God and walking with people, but also to be forgettable so that after I meet with somebody one-on-one or I administer the sacraments in any way, that they don't necessarily remember me in the interaction, but that Christ comes to them and they remember that encounter.
In chapter 34 of the book of Ezekiel, he says that there are many shepherds who are feeding themselves and they are not feeding the sheep. The shepherds are supposed to feed the sheep. I want to be a shepherd that feeds the sheep and doesn't feed himself.
That's how I would want to be remembered, is as this priest that is always there for his people, the father that shows up. And I think of my own dad. As a kid, didn't realize, you know, the sacrifices that it would take on his part to make sure he was always there, because he never made it seem like a burden. And that would, I think, be my goal as a priest, is to be known as the priest who's always there.
If a young man feels that something's been put in his heart and he's thinking about it and discerning it, I would say probably the most important thing is don't hyper-focus on the call. The call to the priesthood is a word that the Lord speaks in friendship. And so to hear the call, just focus on becoming friends with the Lord.
Don't be afraid to take the next step, whatever that step is, you know, because everyone is at a different place in their discernment. So whether it's even just talking to a close friend or talking to your pastor, coming on a discernment weekend. Before I entered seminary, there was something off. There was a discontent there. And it was only once I surrendered my plans and said, okay, Lord, I'll take this step, that discontent went away. And I realized, okay, this is the piece that was missing, even though I couldn't see it.
There's a lot out in the world that says this is not a life that's happy. This is not a life that can be fulfilling. But for me, even the worst day, when I go to bed at night and I say this day has been absolutely horrible, I go to bed that night thinking, there's no other life for me. I'm still happy. Even in the midst of that suffering or that trial, I want nothing else in life but to be his priest. And God willing, it'll happen.
Our goal was really to bring men together to pray together, to have some fraternity with each other. You know, iron sharpens iron, one man sharpens another. Proverbs 27 tells us that. And so men get stronger when they're together. They encourage each other. But also, I mean, the goal of having speakers here was that men can go away better equipped to live their Catholic life as sacramental men, prayerful men, and men of purity.
My name is Tim Likes. I haven't been to a conference in a while, and I tend to get a lot out of these. I've been to several, mostly just to grow in my faith and understanding of Jesus Christ and to convert even further. Father Athanasius, his talk on purity of heart, I found very enlightening. I was reminded of the practice of Lectio Divina, which is something that I tend to get a lot from, but I forget to do or not as disciplined as I'd like to be with that.
I think there are huge challenges, especially men not understanding the role they have, the unique role they have in their masculinity to glorify God by being truly men. They don't have to compromise and become less than men, but that their masculinity is about self-sacrifice.
Being Catholic is central to who I am. It's my primary identity. You know, I intend to really reflect on the scriptures a whole lot more, but what it is to be a good Catholic man and how I'm gonna exhibit that to my soon-to-be child.
That the shepherding of God is made present and real in flesh and blood in the church.
I give thanks to God for the call you have received.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Peace be with you. As always, when the Holy Spirit gathers God's people together, we rejoice in celebrating the resurrection of the Lord, his Passover mystery by which we have life. But today, the special joy is to celebrate the inauguration of Bishop Monforton's ministry here in the Archdiocese. And so we offer this Holy Eucharist with him and for him. We are particularly blessed to have present with us Cardinal Christophe Pierre, Your Eminence. Thank you for coming as our Holy Father's personal representative. One more sign that we live in communion with Peter and that what we do here was part of the life of the Church. So we have a great duty to perform, an office, this holy mystery. Let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, what I have done and in what I have failed to do. Through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask, Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Amen. Excelsis Deo.
Thank you.
Let us pray. O God, who in each pilgrim church throughout the world make visible the one holy Catholic and apostolic church, graciously grant that your faithful may be so united to their shepherd and gathered together in the Holy Spirit through the gospel and the Eucharist as to worthily embody the universality of your people and become a sign and instrument in the world of the presence of Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Rise up in splendor, Jerusalem, your light has come. The glory of the Lord shines upon you. See, darkness covers the earth, and thick clouds cover the peoples. But upon you the Lord shines, and over you appears his glory. Nations shall walk by your light, and kings by your shining radiance. Raise your eyes and look about. They all gather and come to you. Your sons come from afar, and your daughters in the arms of their nurses. Then you shall be radiant at what you see. Your heart shall throb and overflow, for the riches of the sea shall be emptied out before you. The wealth of nations shall be brought to you. Caravans of camels shall fill you. Dromedaries from Midian and Ephah, all from Sheba shall come, bearing gold and frankincense, and proclaiming the praises of the Lord. The word of the Lord.
God bless us in his mercy.
May God bless us in his mercy.
May God have pity on us and bless us. May he let his face shine upon us. So may your way be known upon earth, among all nations, your salvation.
May God bless us in his mercy.
May the nations be glad and exalt, because you rule the peoples in equity, the nations on the earth you guide.
May God bless us in his mercy.
May the peoples praise you, O God. May all the peoples praise you. May God bless us, and may all the ends of the earth fear him. May God bless us in his mercy.
Lectura de la carta del apóstol San Pablo a los Efesios. Bendito sea Dios, Padre de nuestro Señor Jesucristo, que nos ha bendecido en Él con toda clase de bienes espirituales y celestiales. Él nos eligió en Cristo antes de crear el mundo, para que fuéramos santos e irreprochables a sus ojos por el amor. Y determinó, porque así lo quiso, que por medio de Jesucristo fuéramos sus hijos, para que alabemos y glorifiquemos la gracia con que nos ha favorecido por medio de su Hijo amado. Pues por Cristo, por su sangre, hemos recibido la redención, el perdón de los pecados. Él ha prodigado sobre nosotros el tesoro de su gracia, con toda la sabiduría e inteligencia, dándonos a conocer el misterio de su voluntad. Este es el plan que había proyectado realizar por Cristo, cuando llegara la plenitud de los tiempos, hacer que todas las cosas, las del cielo y las de la tierra, tuvieran a Cristo por cabeza. Con Cristo somos herederos también nosotros. Para esto estábamos destinados, por decisión del que lo hace con todo según su voluntad, para que fuéramos una alianza continua de su gloria, nosotros, los que ya antes esperábamos en Cristo. En Él también, ustedes después de escuchar la palabra de la verdad, el evangelio de su salvación, y después de creer, han sido marcados con el Espíritu Santo prometido. Este Espíritu es la garantía de nuestra herencia, mientras llega la liberación del pueblo adquirido por Dios para alabanza de su gloria. Palabra de Dios.
From the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Jesus went into the region of Caesarea Philippi and asked his disciples, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" They replied, "Some say John the Baptist, others Elijah, still others Jeremiah or one of the prophets." He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter said in reply, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Jesus said to him in reply, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my heavenly Father. And so I say to you, you are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of the netherworld shall not prevail against it. I will give you the keys to the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus
In a few moments, it will be my office to call upon the nuncio, Cardinal Pierre, to read the letter of our Holy Father by which Bishop Monforton is missioned to us here. But I'm going to take this moment to offer a word of congratulations on behalf of this whole local church, Your Eminence, on your being made a cardinal, a member of the Holy Father's Senate. And one more way that we, the local churches here in the United States, are more firmly bound to the Vicar of Peter. And so congratulations from all of us. And please assure our Holy Father, Pope Francis, of our love and communion and thanksgiving that he's giving us one more laborer in the vineyard so that we can follow his mandate to live the gospel in joy. So please, Your Eminence, the mandate.
Archbishop Vigneron, you know, I like to come here from time to time only to pronounce your name. Archbishop Vigneron. Dear bishops and priests, deacons, religious members of the lay faithful, dear friends, it is an honor for me to be here in order to represent the Holy Father as Bishop Monforton. By the way, Monforton is also a French name, isn't it? Bishop Monforton is welcome back to his home Archdiocese as one of its auxiliary bishops. Allow me to convey to all of you the Pope's spiritual closeness and paternal affection. In a homily last Friday, Pope Francis recalled the very first words with which Pope Benedict described himself following his election: a humble laborer in the vineyard of the Lord. Pope Francis said, I quote, "Indeed, Christians, especially the Pope, the cardinals, and the bishops, are called to be humble laborers, to serve, not to be served, and to put the fruits of the Lord's vineyard before their advantage. What a fine thing it is to renounce ourselves for the Church of Jesus." End of quote. Bishop Monforton, your years of priestly and episcopal ministry have shown you the truth of these words. From your work in parishes, to teaching in high school, to serving as a cardinal secretary, to being a seminary rector, and most recently, your 11 years as Bishop of Steubenville, you have been a laborer in the Lord's vineyard. By continuing to live your episcopal motto, faith comes from hearing, you will listen both to the voice of the Holy Spirit and to the people of God in order to serve this local church in the manner to which our Lord is now calling you. Be assured then of the comforting joy of the gospel, which will accompany both you and the members of the faithful in your ministry in the Archdiocese. I will now read a translation of the papal decree of your appointment, and you will have the joy to show it to your people later. Francis, Bishop, servant of the servants of God. To our beloved brother, Jeffrey Mark Monforton, until now Ordinary of Steubenville, appointed Auxiliary of the Metropolitan Archdiocese of Detroit, and at the same time named titular Bishop of Centuria, greetings and the apostolic blessing. Clothing ourselves with both harmony and humility, and following the path of truth, we, who believe in the Lord, from whom life in immortality, splendor in righteousness, truth in boldness, faith in confidence, temperance in sanctification are subject of our understanding, must in no respect be idle and careless regarding every good work. Sharing in this pastoral mission, it is with fatherly love that we direct our attention to the needs of the flock of Detroit, whose ordinary, our venerable brother Allen Henry Vigneron. Not very long ago requested that he be able to enjoy the assistance of an auxiliary to help in the governance of the life of the Archdiocese. Accordingly, we think of you, venerable brother, who, in our judgment, are suitable for undertaking these new pastoral responsibilities. Therefore, upon consultation with the Dicastery for Bishops, by the fullness of our apostolic authority, we release you from the bond of the aforementioned local church, and we appoint you auxiliary bishop in the Metropolitan Ecclesial Community of Detroit, promoting you titular Bishop of Centuria, as well as conferring upon you the due rights and imposing the relative obligations which are connected to this office. Finally, venerable brother, as we earnestly exhort you to apply your episcopal energy in close collaboration with the chief shepherd of this church, we implore Almighty God, together with the prayerful intercession of the Blessed Virgin Mary and that of Saint Joseph, her spouse, to assist you so that, by word and by example, you may be a blessing for these people, that they may merit to become sharers in the life of his Son. Given at Rome, at St. John Lateran, on the 28th day of the month of September, in the year of the Lord 2023, the 11th of our pontificate, and it is signed Pope Francis.
Praise be Jesus Christ. There's a step stool here. I don't know if I'm supposed to use it or not. Your Eminence, Archbishop Pierre. Your Excellency, Archbishop Vigneron, and my brother auxiliary bishops, Cepeda, Battersby, Fisher, and the one who's smiling a lot, Bishop Hanschen, who's recently retired. All my brother bishops, priests, deacons, consecrated women and men, Mom, and my entire family, and my dear friends. Well, Mom. I can read my mother's facial expression. She's smiling, but in her head she's saying, "This is the last time I'm coming to his homily." All my dear friends, here this afternoon, in the words of St. Peter, this wasn't the gospel passage today, but on Mount Tabor, at the Transfiguration, for us, those words prove true. Lord, it is good that we are here. Señor, bien es que nos quedemos aquí. It is good to be home. Es bueno estar en casa. All for Jesus. Todo para Jesús. The Mount Tabor exclamation from St. Peter in the Gospel according to Matthew immediately follows the previous chapter in which St. Peter exclaims, Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of the living God. Two chapters earlier, Jesus invited St. Peter to walk on water in the evening at the Sea of Galilee. It seems to me these three gospel stories underscore Jesus' question to St. Peter and to us. But who do you say that I am? My dear brothers and sisters, it is Jesus who enables a disciple to walk on water. It is Jesus who provides the disciples with the glimpse of his glory and a sneak peek at heaven, eternal life with God. It is Jesus who establishes a disciple as rock, the first pope in a church established by Jesus Christ himself. It is Jesus who enables, better yet, empowers us fellow disciples to unleash the gospel in Southeast Michigan and beyond. All for Jesus. Todo para Jesús. A couple of years ago, Your Eminence Cardinal Pierre, you underscored our Holy Father Pope Francis's insights into the kerygma, the proclamation of the good news. That's not for whom the bell tolls. I guess it tolls for us. The proclamation of the good news. As you referred, it is not a custom. No. The kerygma is the joyful announcement that Jesus Christ is a living person to be encountered. To be encountered. For he has defeated sin and death. It is the joy of the gospel, not the whining of our day, to be offered Jesus is to unleash the gospel. To unleash the gospel begins with three simple words: encounter, encounter, and encounter. We cannot share someone we do not know. Mis queridos hermanos y hermanas, Jesús pide a sus discípulos, Y vosotros, ¿quién decís que soy? Esa es una muy buena pregunta, ¿no? Sí. Estos tres relatos del Evangelio nos proporcionan a Jesús dándole a un discípulo la capacidad de caminar sobre el agua. En la transfiguración, es Jesús quien proporciona a los discípulos una visión de su gloria y una breve visión del cielo, la vida eterna con Dios. Es Jesús quien cambia el nombre de un discípulo. Tú eres Pedro, y sobre esta piedra edificaré mi iglesia. Tenemos el primer Papa. Es Jesús quien nos da poder a nosotros, con discípulos, a leer el Evangelio. ¿No? Sí. Todo para Jesús. Eminencia Cardinal Pierre, usted citó a nuestro Santo Padre, o Papa Francisco, sobre su visión del carisma. No es una costumbre. El carisma es anuncio gozos. Gozo de que Jesús Cristo es una persona viva a la que encontrar porque ha vencido el pecado y la muerte. Es la alegría del Evangelio. Es la alegría del Evangelio. No la queja de nuestros días. Haz leer el Evangelio. Tres palabras sencillas. Encuentro, encuentro, encuentro. No podemos compartir a Jesús si no conocemos a Jesús. Nos encontramos con Jesús y anunciamos a Jesús. ¿Quién sabe qué impacto podemos tener? Encounter, encounter, encounter. Who knows what impact we make? How we learn from others. In my 11 years as a bishop in the Diocese of Steubenville, during Catholic Schools Week, I would make a point to visit every one of the 11 schools to celebrate Mass with each one of the schools as well, and to engage in an impromptu ask the bishop with the students. If they care about their faith, they're going to ask questions. They deserve an answer. Well, one year, I had finished visiting a lot of the classrooms, and it was lunchtime. So I went downstairs where the students were eating, and I sat down with the second graders. They looked at me with their eyes wide open. The bishop eats. Well, I was there with my hot dog with a little mustard, well, a lot of mustard. Mom knows that mustard is a food group for me. And my tater tots, my fruit cup, as well as my white milk. I picked up the hot dog, and just before I bit into it, the young 7-year-old gentleman in front of me looked at me and he goes, "Remember, Bishop, chew with your mouth closed." I had a reputation, or my mom called him. But he had to learn that from somebody. And that's what we're meant to be. I mean, we're hopefully far enough for me to say this, but we're supposed to be contagious with holiness, with the Holy Spirit. That is to unleash the gospel. And we do it joyfully. My dear friends, when we unleash the gospel, we celebrate the joy of the gospel. Who knows what positive influence we may leave with others we encounter? And Jesus asks us today, who do we believe he is? Jesus Christ is the Son of God, our Savior. It is Jesus Christ himself who has changed ordinary time into extraordinary ordinary time through his passion, death, and resurrection. Certainly, this is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice in it and be glad. Todo para Jesus, all for Jesus. God bless you all. Amen.
Once we were no people. We did not belong to God. But by the grace of the Lord's death and rising, we've been ransomed from that miserable state and made God's own people. And so we can be confident that when we offer these petitions, God our Father welcomes them and will respond by giving us all that we require.
Let us pray for the Church, especially for our Holy Father, Pope Francis, for Cardinal Pierre, Archbishop Vigneron, and for this particular Church, as we welcome Bishop Monforton as our auxiliary bishop. May the grace of the Holy Spirit open our hearts so that we may be authentic witnesses to the love of Jesus. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for world peace and for the end of violence which causes suffering for so many people throughout the world. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us pray for the family and friends of Bishop Monforton as they welcome him home to the Archdiocese of Detroit. May they know great joy and keep him in their prayers as he serves as auxiliary bishop in Southeast Michigan. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray that we may all recognize the dignity of human life from conception to natural death, We also pray for all who will be participating in Lansing tomorrow for the celebration of the Holy Mass and the Michigan March for Life. May our prayers be heard on behalf of the unborn and vulnerable. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for the faithful departed, particularly during this month of November, for the holy souls in purgatory. May they soon know the happiness of eternal life in heaven. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, again and again we come to you because you are all mercy. Hear these petitions. Grant us everything that is for your glory and the salvation of our world through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father. Celebrating the memorial of your Son's boundless love, we humbly beseech you, O Lord, that through the ministry of your church, the fruits of his saving work may advance the salvation of all the world through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. Up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For when your children were scattered afar by sin, through the blood of your Son and the power of the Holy Spirit, you gathered them again to yourself, that a people formed as one by the unity of the Trinity made the body of Christ and the temple of the Holy Spirit might, to the praise of your manifold wisdom, be manifest as the church. And so, in company with the choirs of angels, we praise you, and with joy we proclaim. Therefore, most merciful Father, we make humble prayer and petition through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, that you accept and bless these gifts, these offerings, these holy and unblemished sacrifices, which we offer you firstly for your holy Catholic Church. Be pleased to grant her peace, to guard, unite, and govern her throughout the whole world, together with your servant Francis, our Pope, me, your unworthy servant, my assistant bishops, our emeritus bishops, and all those who, holding to the truth, hand on the Catholic and apostolic faith.
Remember, O Lord, your servants, and all gathered here, whose faith and devotion are known to you. For them, we offer you this sacrifice of praise, for they offer it for themselves and all who are dear to them for the redemption of their souls in hope of health and well-being and paying their homage to you, the eternal God, living and true.
in communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glorious ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, and Blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, James, John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon, and Jude, Linus, Cletus, Clement, Sixtus, Cornelius, Cyprian, Lawrence, Chrysogonus, John and Paul, Cosmas and Damian, and all your saints. We ask that through their merits and prayers, in all things, we may be defended by your protecting help.
Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service, that of your whole family. Order our days in your peace, and command that we be delivered from eternal damnation and counted among the flock of those you have chosen. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect. Make it spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands, and with eyes raised to heaven, to you, O God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands, and once more giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the Blessed Passion, the resurrection from the dead, and the glorious ascension into heaven of Christ, your Son, our Lord, we, your servants and your holy people, offer to your glorious majesty, from the gifts that you have given us, this pure victim, this holy victim, this spotless victim, the holy bread of eternal life and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to look upon these offerings with a serene and kindly countenance, and to accept them as once you were pleased to accept the gifts of your servant Abel the just, the sacrifice of Abraham, our father in faith, and the offering of your high priest Melchizedek, a holy sacrifice, a spotless victim. In humble prayer, we ask you, Almighty God, command that these gifts be borne by the hands of your holy angel to your altar on high, in the sight of your divine majesty, so that all of us who through this participation at the altar receive the most holy body and blood of your Son may be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing.
Remember also, Lord, your servants, gone before us with the sign of faith and rest in the sleep of peace. Grant them, O Lord, we pray, and all who sleep in Christ, a place. place of refreshment, light, and peace.
To us also, your servants, with all sinners, hoping your abundant mercies, graciously grant some share in fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and all your saints. Admit us, we beseech you, into their company, not waiting our merits, but granting us your pardon, through Christ our Lord.
Through whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord, you sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them, and bestow them upon us.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom of our
Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Let us share with one another the sign of peace.
Peace, thank you.
Peace be with you, thank you. Thank you. Peace be with you.
You always help. Thank you.
Peace be with you, our children. Peace to you. Welcome.
Thank you.
Peace be with you. Thank you, Mike.
Thank you.
you by this, your most holy body and blood from all my sins. From every evil, keep me always faithful to your commandments. Never let me be pardoned for my own.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed.
Thank you.
Let us pray. In this, your church, O Lord, may integrity of faith, holiness of life, fraternal charity, and pure religion flourish and abide until the end. And as you did not fail to feed her with the body of your Son and with your word, so also never cease, we pray, to guide her under your protection through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please be seated.
Praise be Jesus Christ, now and forever. First of all, I promise this will not be homily part two, okay? My dear friends in Christ, you honor me today with your presence as we celebrate my return home for Episcopal ministry in our beloved Archdiocese of Detroit. In this very apostolic theme, I am both honored and humbled at the presence of Cardinal Pierre, the apostolic nuncio, to the United States of America. Your Eminence, to echo Archbishop's words, please convey to our Holy Father, Pope Francis, our love and fidelity to the Vicar of Christ. Your Excellency, Archbishop Vigneron, please know of my profound gratitude to assist you as you serve the Archdiocese of Detroit as its chief shepherd. My brother bishops, I very much look forward to our collegial work as together we serve our Lord Jesus Christ as successors of the apostles. My brother priests, deacons, fellow religious and consecrated virgins of the Archdiocese of Detroit, you enjoy my utmost profound respect and love. I am here for you as together we build up the body of Christ in our beloved Archdiocese. Also, my brother priests and deacons from near and far, especially those who have traveled far or religious, a shout out to the Daughters of Holy Mary of the Heart of Jesus who have come here today from the Diocese of Steubenville. Our Christian pilgrimage continues as we declare with our lives, the kingdom of God is at hand. A note of gratitude to all who prepared for these past couple of days. A special shout out to Mrs. Katie Tremblay and the Archdiocesan Chancery staff, as well as Father Stephen Burr and the Sacred Heart Major Seminary staff, not to mention, of course, the Cathedral staff, and all who have helped prepare for this liturgy. And finally, to my family and friends here today, many of you sacrificed time as well as significant gas money to be here. I thank you for your presence as we continue our common Christian journey in the Lord. And this leads to my family, Dan and Jen and David virtually on the TV. We are blessed to have one another as family. Mom, you know of my love. And I have every confidence that Dad is smiling this day. We both now are Detroiters and Michiganders again. Not to mention we are nearly neighbors as well. Now I know where to get my meals. And Mom already has enough mustard, I'm sure, at home prepared ready for me. To all of us here in the Archdiocese of Detroit, I am delighted to serve you as your auxiliary bishop, one of your auxiliary bishops. I am yours. And in the words of St. Augustine of Hippo, for you I am a bishop, and with you I am a Christian. Amen.
And one final word thank you, Bishop Monforton, for agreeing to the mission our Holy Father has proposed to you to come here and serve. We're very grateful, and this yes on your part is a reminder of all of us about our own yes to serve in the kingdom. So thank you very, very much.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Blessed be the name of the Lord. Our help is in the name of the Lord. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace.
Thanks be to God.
As Catholics, we pray, worship, and live in holy spaces, from grandiose cathedrals to tiny adoration chapels where we meet Jesus in the Blessed Sacrament. But what about our final resting place? A Catholic burial in consecrated ground among fellow believers is the sacred rite of every Catholic. A tradition since the catacombs, it is the final expression of our Catholic faith, a silent witness to our hope in the resurrection. Archdiocese of Detroit Catholic cemeteries provide an environment of comfort and solace for loved ones, a powerful reminder of our eternal life with Jesus Christ. Offer your family this gift by planning for your eternal rest in a Catholic cemetery. To learn more about the work of Catholic funeral and cemetery services, our history, and our Catholic burial traditions, call and visit one of our locations today. We're ready to help ensure that your wishes are met and provide peace of mind for yourself and your loved ones.
The mission of Catholic schools is to remember that it is God that forms our children and not man.
Kids today face so many challenges and so many outside forces. They need Jesus as their guide.
Because of Catholic schools, I became Catholic. So I think it's a huge evangelization tool.
There are many alternatives to Catholic education, but there are no substitutes.
School, we know that our dignity comes from the fact that we are created by God out of love.
Every one of these children is unrepeatable with a mission that only they can complete in this world. And I think in this world right now, having that confidence, having that faith, having that hope, that even in rough and challenging times, it's not your grade point average or your test scores that are going to pull you up in those times, it's your faith.
I think the integration of Jesus in everyday circumstance, whether it's through the math class, English class, even science, just realizing that God has a hand in all of that, you know, that's, you can only get that at a Catholic school.
Every subject we try to have something that relates to our faith, and I think just being able to do that every day, all day, is going to have a big impact on the kids.
That religion isn't just one subject among many, but that it permeates all the subjects, all of the knowledges, all the disciplines. Through that, they can see that God is active and present in every part of their life. One of the biggest challenges that our students face today is that there are so many voices. And when you have so many of those voices, it can become even more difficult for them to hear the voice of God speaking to them in their own hearts.
And so, you know, for us to be able to give them a moral compass, you know, if we keep our eyes fixed on Jesus, then some of the noise of the world kind of goes away, right? And our path is more clear.
So the greatest gift we received being part of a Catholic school was the gift of baptism. It was through our involvement with Catholic schools that we decided that we would take the leap of faith and become Catholic. Neither Anthony or myself had been baptized, and so we received all of our sacraments.
Yeah, I think that our children drive our growth in our faith. You know, as they're learning more about the Catholic faith, they have questions, and they're asking. We look for answers, and when we look for answers, you know, we look to Mass, we look to the Bible. Ultimately, we look to Jesus, and that's where we find it.
So even if I'm a member of the parish and I don't have children in the school, I know that that contributes to the good of the parish and contributes to the mission of the parish, that we exist to form hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of the Lord. And that's what happens each and every day at the school.
The kids come through, obviously we see them, and then we see their brothers and we see their sisters, and I just think it makes it a tight-knit community, and everyone is truly, truly concerned about everyone else. It's not a me, you're just about my child. And I think a lot of that just goes back to our faith, that we're living out what Jesus wanted us to do, to be his disciples, and we see that every day in the way the kids treat other kids, in the way families care for each other, in the way teachers care for each other.
There's no place that does everything that a Catholic school can do for a child, for a family, for the community.
So my hope for every student in Catholic school is that God is not just one part of their life, but that God is very much interested in every part of their life. That interest in them doesn't end when they graduate. And so no matter what they go on to do in their life, they will always be eager to include God in everything that they do.
That the shepherding of God is made present and real in flesh and blood in the church.
I give thanks to God for the call you have received